The Gateway brings you the day's news from the St. Louis region and across Missouri. It also includes stories from the Illinois side of the river and our Metro East reporter, Will Bauer.
In Alton, in Belleville, in East St. Louis, in Edwardsville, in Cahokia Heights, at Scott Air Force Base, I'm Will Bauer, St. Louis Public Radio.
Listen to reports from Will and all of our journalists weekdays on The Gateway, on the STLPR app, and wherever you get podcasts.
Tony Monetti is a Warrensburg native who flew B-2 bombers during his military career, and now he wants to transition into being an elected official. The Republican joins us to talk about his U.S. Senate bid and his views on national issues on the latest edition of Politically Speaking. So let's hit the music.
This is the Politically Speaking podcast, a candid conversation with the Show Me State's biggest political newsmakers.
I'm Jason Rosenbaum.
And I'm Joe Mannis.
That's Eric Greitens, Navy SEALs running for governor, and I'm really, really glad to be on with you, Jason and Joe.
I'm going to push back on these regulators.
I'm doing this for the people.
I was encouraged along the way, not just by my family, but by a lot of teachers and professors, and knew when I was in college that I would run for office someday.
We're very excited about the prospect of having some more free market solutions.
Even though after the conversation, I still might not agree.
We want our listeners to get a real sense of what drives these people.
They're actually people with a story to tell.
And welcome to Politically Speaking. I'm your host, Jason Rosenbaum, a reporter with St. Louis Public Radio. Joining me in studios today in St. Louis is
colleague Joe Mannis.
And joining us all the way from beautiful Warrensburg, Missouri, home of former Senator David Pierce.
Yeah, and also he's wearing a, what, bomber jacket?
Yes, I've flown combat missions with this Lieutenant Colonel Tony Monetti with you.
You are one of the 20 people, literally 20 people, who have signed up to run for the U.S. Senate seat currently held by Claire McCaskill. Not all of them are Republicans. There are some Democrats.
Yeah, about almost, not quite half-half. There's a few more Republicans than Democrats.
There's actually two Green Party people running now in
yes,
a primary.
So I think there's, what, 10 Republicans, 8 Democrats, and 2 Green Party?
I don't know.
Something like that.
Well, I was the first candidate to announce, and I got news for you. I'm going to be your next U.S. Senator.
So as
you
I
know, George W. Bush told me that once, to my face.
There you go.
So as I mentioned in the show with Austin Peterson, we are having some of the 20 on the show. They're people that have raised in the six figures, who are actively campaigning, that have, you know, endorsers or some semblance of support. Just because you say crazy things into a telephone receiver does not mean that you'll be able to get on the show. So enough shade. I want to know a little bit more about you. I want to know why you're running for the U.S. Senate, and then we'll get into the campaign and issues.
Sure. Sounds great. You know, I was born and raised the son of legal Italian immigrants and went to United States Air Force Academy, served my country nearly a quarter of a century. I was literally living the American dream, a kid that always wanted to fly jets for United States Air Force, and next thing I know, I got jets on my back going supersonic, flying B-52s in Desert Storm, defending America, B-1 supersonic bombers, and I was IQT number 7, the very first cadre selected to fly the B-2 stealth bomber right here in Warrensburg. Got here in 94 and never turned back. I just love it out here, and when I retired, I started my restaurant, Christian author, motivational speaker, assistant
dean.
Tell
us about the restaurant. What kind of restaurant?
Sure, yeah, great Irish food at Monetti's restaurant.
Really?
No. You ever hear of Sbarro's? You ever see Sbarro's in all the airports?
Yes.
Well, I used to work for Mr. Sbarro when he had only one restaurant when I was a teenager. I was always working. And he taught me the restaurant business. And I love people. I like food. Forget about your Italian, you know.
Yeah.
And when I retired, I was like, what kind of Italian doesn't want to have a restaurant? You know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
So I opened Monetti's. We have New York-style pizza, Italian food. Learned a lot about paying paychecks.
Where are you?
In Warrensburg, in Missouri. Yeah, it's right in the middle of 214 East Colton is the specific address. So, you know, it's a place where you can literally make believe you're coming over my house. That's what I would, whenever I train our team, it's always about training and developing people, you know. And I say, make believe people coming over my house. I go into the bathrooms when I bring new people on. I go, let's go check out how clean the bathroom is. Because that's how I judge a restaurant.
Yeah, actually, so do I.
Do you too? And I'll never.
Poor old Jason sitting here.
He's probably going, what are we talking about here? No, but, you know, just recently, Mr. Sbarro taught me this lesson. When I was at Monetti's, I literally got on my knees and I cleaned both, scrubbed both toilets, did the sinks. And they're like, get up. You might be a U.S. Senator. I go, it doesn't matter. There's no job beneath me that I'm going to ask you to do. Mm. And then more importantly, I expect them to be clean this way, if you don't mind.
Well, you know? I actually have a restaurant anecdote before we get into the next thing. I never worked at a restaurant, but I worked at a restaurant supply depot. And my job there during my freshman year of college was literally to just dust the shelves and cut boxes. And I was paid $6 an hour in cash, which meant I was an undocumented worker, by the way. And one day I was cutting boxes with a box cutter, stabbed myself right here, started bleeding profusely, and then cleaned it up, started cutting boxes again, cut myself right here. So I cut myself twice in the same finger. The next day they were like, you're not working here anymore, because if they find out that you're working here and we're paying you in cash, we could probably get in trouble. But I did learn a lot, and that truism that there is no lowest job you can do, I actually did take away something from that. I still can't really feel feeling in my ring finger, though.
Yeah, sorry to hear that.
Yeah.
No, but you're right. You know, you learn a lot when you work. You know, hard work, this is part of our American culture, you know. And I grew up, you know, learning the value of 75 cents an hour. That's how much I used to get paid at some
places. Yeah, that's what I made my first job at the Dairy Queen, which I won't.
Let's not go there.
I made $6 an hour at that aforementioned job, but continue.
No, but that's fine. But, you know, as a business owner, I know how hard it is, you know. And I grew up, my dad was an electrician. Both my brothers are union guys. I know how hard it is to work in today's environment. And I grew up with just the value of living the American dream and serving my country. I almost died in defense of her, and I'm just ready to serve again. I just, you know, besides the restaurant, I think one of the most rewarding experience I've had was in academia when they were president of the university and the dean asked if I'd come on as the new assistant dean of aviation and
at the University
of Central Missouri.
Okay.
Do you still hold that position?
No, I had to step down, unfortunately. They met with me and they were very respectful. They said there's a state statute that states if I'm a state employee, I can't remain on running for federal office. So, you know, I told my wife that. She's like, well, who's going to pay the mortgage? I go, you're my sugar mama.
Well,
So how does all of the, there is a connection here. So you're doing all this. What made you decide to run for the U.S. Senate as opposed to even like state rep or state senator? You're going for the big kahuna.
Yeah. Well, you know, I happen to be a man of faith. Like I told you, I almost died in my first combat mission. After that, I promised God I'd do my best to serve other people over self. And I literally woke up one day at 3 a.m. and I felt a calling that I was going to be the next U.S. senator. And I had a similar calling once before, and that's when I had a vision of starting a Big Brothers and Sisters in the late, you know, I think it was early 90s. And I just acted on that calling, and we've matched 1,000 kids to date. So I really believe I'm going to be your next U.S. senator, because this is something that when you're called to do something, you do it, and you act on faith. And I'm hoping that there's going to be enough people listening out there that will respect the fact that I'm a person of faith and taking a step of faith and doing what needs to be done. Because I hate to see what's going on in this country. I'll be honest with you. I'm a uniter. I'm not a divider. I see these people just tearing each other apart. You're not going to hear me talking bad about Senator Claire McCaskill, about these other people running. I think we're so sick and tired of demonization of other people. Just tell me, what are you going to do to improve my life? You know, how about we go there? What kind of experiences can you bring to the table, to bring people together to solve these complex problems? I don't know about you, but we're just done with this. And that's why there's guys like me rising up saying enough of the madness. We're going to put ourselves out there, and hopefully there's enough people who are saying enough of the status quo of these elitists that throwing all this kind of money and $50,000 chicken dinners thinking that that's when it's going to win it for us. No, we need to stand up for this country and do what's right. Because otherwise, we're going to have to ask ourselves, how's that working for us so far?
Well, that segue, let's just get this out of the way now.
Let's do it.
Because I think we need to just talk about this on the outset before we talk about issues.
Sure.
So Attorney General Josh Hawley is also running for this seat. He has raised far more money than either you or Austin Peterson, who I consider the next two viable Republican candidates, because you met those thresholds that I kind of jokingly talked about at the beginning of the show.
But we're
serious. I mean, as I mentioned, you've raised over $200,000. You have an active campaign. I think that there are former members of the Trump administration who are interested in endorsing you. But it seems like Hawley is the chosen candidate here. Even Trump himself has come in and done a fundraiser for him. So how do you compete against that?
The American people are competing against that. Now, here's what's happening. I've been doing this for a year. I was the first candidate to announce. I said, I'm not exploring anything. I'm a B2 pilot. You know, I do what's got to be done. Mm-hmm. And I've been doing this for a year. I got a pickup truck, and I'm literally going around the country and the state really just meeting with
people. In fact, I think I saw you when you were on the state capitol, your announcement on the steps.
Yes.
This was what, last spring?
Yes.
Because it was a hot day. I remember that.
It was a great day. It was a glorious day.
I started right here. I have some photographs because I took some pictures.
But continue.
Yeah, that's cool. No, I remember that day. It was a beautiful day. And it was a year ago almost. So,
yes.
You know, getting back to the, let's be real. Everyone tells me, you can't win. You don't have the name ID. You don't have the money. Well, can't never did anything. That's the way I look at it. You know, and that just fires me up and excites me even more. When I was at the Air Force Academy, both my roommates quit. And the upperclassmen told me, you need to quit. You don't have what it takes. But I looked them in the eyes and I laughed and I said, no, sir, I'm going to make it. You know, the Air Force Academy taught me the value of integrity, excellence, service before self, and doing everything you got when you don't have anything left. You see, I've been prepared for this moment in time. And when people say I can't do it, it just fires me up even more. And I really, truly believe that the American people, when I meet with them, they all tell me the same thing. This is what I'm hearing. They're telling me, Tony, Josh Hawley ran on a ladders commercial. He said he's going to be our attorney general, not going to go climbing a ladder and being, you know, going for the next thing. And I was like, you know what? You know, I'm not even, I understand. He probably said that. Now, you know, these guys are saying, hey, you have name, ID, and money. You could just see him hanging out going, who's going to be the next senator? I tell you what, let's throw $10 million at this guy. He's going to win. Not knowing that there's a guy like me at the grassroots level that's going to mess up their plans. And here's what's happening. People are going, this is what they're saying to me, at least. We don't want another 37-year-old attorney. There's 50% of them that are attorneys in the Congress. Less than 20% are veterans. They prefer to put a veteran that's going to do what they say they're going to do rather than the current status quo. Otherwise, you have to ask yourself, how's that working for you so far?
So what do you see as your biggest issues, the things that you're highlighting?
Yeah, we're going to spend the next 20 minutes or so going through issues.
Let's go. Let's start. I look forward to it. By the way, I look forward to debating the issues with anyone, anywhere, anytime, because I've been studying the issues. Let's go right off the bat. Most people get shocked when I say this. My number one issue I'm most passionate about is mental health. Mm-hmm. I've been pounding this drum for the longest time. My wife's a mental health counselor, and she helps veterans with PTSD, and I have family members that suffer with it. And so I've been trying to bring out the importance of the Constitution, saying we should promote the general welfare. We need to do a better job of helping our people that have a pre-existing condition. And let's help people with mental health. There's ways we can do it. But let's talk about the three issues that I focus on, right? First of all, I always go over the Constitution and the culture, changing the culture in D.C. How do we do that? Well, we need someone that's going to be a conservative as far as understanding what the value of the Constitution is. First Amendment. How can we have these free speech zones at universities? I work at a university. Our First Amendment right to free speech, you shouldn't take that away from us. Come on, man. Second Amendment, our rights should not be infringed upon. I mean, we need to honor the fact that, you know, guns don't kill people. We already know that bad people or people that have mental illness, unfortunately, they snap sometimes, and this is what happens. So we really need to do a better job of understanding the value of the Second Amendment and our founding fathers, what they had in mind. And I truly believe it's because they didn't trust the government. And neither do I. And now let's look at the other issues as it pertains to culture. We have a culture right now that believes more about common core than core values. We need to go back at respecting people's faiths, not making fun of them when they believe something. We should be able to not believe in God if we don't want to. But if we do, don't make fun of us and let us lead our life the way we want to. We need to tell men and women, let's do a better job of taking care of our families, not depending on the big government. I want less federal government in our lives, more state and local government. Second thing is infrastructure. How is it possible that we spend $1 trillion in some of these countries overseas? And we don't even spend $1 billion right here in St. Louis fixing some of these bridges.
Well,
that
was going to be my question. Let me dive right in. This is the first question I asked Austin Peterson. One of the main duties of a senator is when, God forbid, we have to vote on whether to go to war with somebody. The Senate is often seen as the main roadblock to potentially checking the president's power. As somebody who was in the military, what would be your philosophy?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked me. Thank you.
You're welcome. I think it's actually one of the most important duties
so
of a senator.
Who do you think knows more about war than a warrior that's almost died? Spent a quarter of a century, Air Force Academy. I mean, the things I've seen, the things I've done. No one hates war more than the military warrior and their families. No one, I assure you, none of us say, we can't wait to go to war. They were not like that. It's the scariest thing to go in day after day getting shot at and almost dying and knowing that there's people dying. We don't want to do that. It should be our last resort. And I think in this country, we've done a terrible job of just going out and doing what we think is the right thing and feeling, and they don't have the guts to stand up and say enough. It should be the House and the Senate debating it, declaring war. World War II is when our country was united, and we as a nation said, the Nazi regime shall not stand, and neither shall what they did to us in Pearl Harbor, right, with the Japanese. And why? How did we do as a nation? Great, because the House and the Senate and the president were united. The people were behind it. What do we have now? We have literally presidents think, you know, using the War Powers Act and the senators not doing what they should be doing. And what we need are senators that are going to stand up and say, hold on a second. Your job should be to provide for the common defense. So just tell me exactly how and why is this war important to protect and defend Americans?
If you had been a senator in 2003, would you have voted for the Iraq War?
Okay, that's an outstanding question. And
as somebody who was in Desert Storm.
Yeah, yes. Which was the first one?
No, the first one was 1991. That was
correct.
Desert Storm.
Correct. Okay. But yeah, that's right. Kind of so like Act 1 and Act 2.
I am going to let you know what I truly... By the way, I'm not a politician, right? You know that.
Yeah.
You probably can tell from just hearing me.
Yeah, but if you become a U.S. senator, you will be a politician.
I hear you. And I will be. And here's the deal, ready? I know there's going to be a lot of listeners out there going, I can't believe he just said that, but I got news for you. I really don't think we should have. I really don't. Mm-hmm. I really think it was a shame.
Well,
if you ask me,
2003 ended up disintegrating the country and all that.
It's all about oil. Come on, man. Most of us didn't even know where Kuwait was. Mm-hmm. And if we really care about humanitarian and relief and problems, what about what's going on in Africa at around the same time in the early 90s, where hundreds of thousands of people are dying? What are we doing there? Go talking to me about. No, you see, this is what's wrong with this country right now. Mm-hmm. You got a bunch of politicians and lobbyists and all this money. Now, how and why do we go to certain wars that make no sense to me? It's because you have people who don't really know what they're doing. Or you have these 35-year politicians. They're in power for 35 years. How's a guy like me, a retired lieutenant colonel, ever going to make it against the $30 million that these guys are going to put up against me? Mm-hmm. How? I'll tell you how. The people that are listening right now are going to say, we've had enough. And we're going to trust a veteran and a business owner and someone that understands education and the value of diversity and bringing people together to solve complex problems. That's how. When you've had enough of the madness, you're going to take a risk and you're going to say, I'm going to look into this person. Look, I truly believe that I'm leading a movement. I mean this. I'm going to become the next U.S. Senator in Missouri. I'm going to upset the balance of power against Josh first and these career Republican establishment elites. Just, I don't even want to talk about them. And then you have these lobbyist groups throwing all kinds of money at us, thinking that that's what we're not. I'm not going to be bought. I'm doing two terms. I'm fighting for a balanced budget amendment. Do I look like the type of guy that when I get to Washington, D.C., and the McConnells of the world say, hey, you got to vote this way. You got to do this. Otherwise, you're going in the basement. Guess what I'm going to tell them? You might as well put me in the basement right now because that's where the action is going to be.
Now, okay, you just mentioned the balanced budget amendment. Now, that's been something that's been bandied around for decades. Now, in a current situation where the Congress, just less than 6 months ago, passed a tax cut package that's going to add at least $1.3 trillion to the debt, and because of tax cuts, now I'm not saying they're good or bad, but I'm just saying everybody agrees it's adding to the debt, okay? The same time, you already have some debt. So if you have a balanced budget amendment with all this going on, this would mean slashing government spending. There's been some estimates by as much as half, just in order, because there wouldn't be the flexibility, which is one of the reasons you've got some Republicans who voted for all this who are now backing off their previous support for the balanced budget amendment because they voted for the tax cuts. So how would you deal with this? I mean, Congress is supposed to be dealing with some sort of an overall $1.3 trillion budget this week. So how would you handle all this?
Okay, great question again. I love you guys because you're bringing up important issues. Restaurant taught me very basic lessons. Are you ready? Sales cures all things. That's what I learned in the restaurant business. when I'm struggling, I could either, you know, cut my employees, my cost of goods, but the budget's a reality. I can't deal with that. I got to balance the books. Or I could use my innovation and creativity as a free market solution kind of guy and figure out how can I increase sales so I can keep people working and at the same time make things happen. Our president gets it. That's why he's president of the United States right now. President Trump ran a business and he says sales cures all things. He didn't say that, but he should have. And that's what happens. Right now they're saying at $1.3 trillion. Well, you haven't looked at that. That's based on a 2% GDP growth.
Correct.
We're at a 3.2%, which is going to bring us in more than $2 trillion, which will watch that 1.3 and out. And now you're 0.7 positive and going up. We all know that the stock markets, for the most part, you got to admit, it's going in a better direction for the last year. We can't, the numbers don't lie. There's another change that I find, that the spirit in the nation has changed as far as business and people, unemployment rate getting lower. There's jobs now. They're maybe not high-paying jobs as much as they should be, but at least there's this culture of businesses coming back to America. So I would have voted for. In fact, I would have made it even higher and stronger as far as the tax benefit.
Okay, you mean as far as the tax cut?
Absolutely,
voted for
more or less more tax, less tax regulations. Caught them.
So what would you cut though in order to balance the budget? Or are you saying there's going to be enough growth you won't have to?
That's what I'm saying. I think it is going to be enough growth. And it's surely the evidence supports what I'm saying. So I'm not just making up fairy tale numbers. Now, here's the problem. We have over a $20 trillion deficit. Forget about
debt. Debt.
No, just think about the debt, $20 trillion.
Correct.
But these guys don't even do a budget. Let alone, I mean, until you actually look at the numbers, you're looking last year at $4.2 trillion. 7% of it, or $303 billion, is going just to pay the interest on the debt alone.
Yes.
Can you imagine that? If you and I to put $7 out of every 100 to just paying the interest on it, no wonder we have problems. You know how much we spend on education? 2%. 7% of the debt. What do we value in this country?
Well,
shouldn't we do a better job on education?
For the most part, state and local governments pay the most of education spending. Would you want more federal government money to go into education?
I would definitely do this if I was in the federal government as far as expenditures going out. I would spend more on infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
I would encourage innovation on our roads, on our railroads. Why don't we have a railroad like they have in Europe? I've been to Europe. I've been to the Far East. Why aren't we spending money improving our airports? We have airports that are like the 40s.
Yeah.
So yes, that's what I would do. I would spend money on infrastructure, which would encourage state and local governments to put people to work.
Well, it's interesting because a lot of conservatives have panned former President Barack Obama for putting money into like high speed rail. I mean, are you one of those conservatives that thought that that was a bad idea? Or do you think that would have actually done a lot of good for the infrastructure of our country?
I will say this. I was not a senator when he was our president.
Yeah.
But I am a person that believes what I just stated, is that we should be spending monies on infrastructure and improving jobs, high paying jobs for workers, and spending more time on and energy on vocational jobs.
Mm-hmm.
As a person that spent the last 5.5 years in academia, I know that there's a lot of kids that are spending a lot of money in college and they don't have a good JOBS afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
Believe me, I know too much about that. But if we spend more opportunities for vocational and community colleges, we can help our young people get an education, which will prepare them for the infrastructure jobs that are coming that can help us. Now, the third thing I want to do is defense. To me, it's one of the third most important things I will do as a veteran that clearly understands. I've had a top secret SCI clearance for the last 20-something years. I've dealt with nuclear weapons. I know the real threats to our country, if you don't mind me saying, because I've been literally fighting them and preparing our nation to defend them. There's likely not going to be many senators in the U.S. Senate that know what I know as far as defense. And I will make sure that the monies being spent on defense are going to be spent on the things that I think are valuable to our nation. Cybersecurity, missile defense, stealth, precision weapons, and computer upgrades. I mean, we must modernize our systems and be number one all the time. Now, we always want peace through strength. We don't want to be aggressive. We aren't as a nation. We are known as a nation that stabilizes. That's why there's NATO. I've served in NATO for 2 years as a chairman of NATO time-sensitive targeting. It was my pleasure to lead 9 nations in the Balkans for peacekeeping operations and bringing nations together to figure out how can we solve many of the complex problems. You see all these life experiences?
Yeah.
You think about how many of these senators, for real, Josh Hawley, good guy, Ivy League school guy, attorney, did a big case, and now he's our young attorney general. Now, that's one guy. Peterson, great guy, you know, small business owner, good guy. I like his ideas, many of his ideas, libertarian. But when it comes to experience, look at me, military, wars, NATO, business, academia, Christian author, motivational speaker, started Big Brother, started Atlanta. You know, all of these weight, you scale. I'm the, you know, I'll stop right there, but the people need to know that I don't have a lot of money. So they got, you want to help me? How about $2 Tuesdays and $5 on Fridays?
I'm not sure this show will help you on that regard. But I do want to, before Joe asks her question, you know, some Republicans have been critical of President Trump because they've disapproved of how he's dealt with countries like Russia. I mean, there's this whole kind of shadow over his entire presidency that Russia may have interfered in his election. I mean, I don't think there's any question that they got involved somehow. I think the question is whether Trump and Russia, like, colluded together or not, which is not clear at this point.
Or if it was just Russia messing around, and we'll probably never know what impact it had. But in any case, it's not healthy.
So what I'm trying to ask is, what do you think of the president's relationship with Russia? Because that seems to be up top of mind right now.
Because it's key for the Senate. Because the Senate ultimately is because they're the ones who passed virtually almost unanimously sanctions against Russia, which have most of which have not been put into place. But how would you deal with some of that if you're in the Senate?
Without question, if we just look at the facts, because we have to look at the merits of the case. Let's be for real here. The FISA court and the whole thing being maybe started by Democrats, and you know, we got to look at the evidence, and now that maybe Hillary Clinton was somewhat involved. I mean, we got to look at the facts that we haven't really heard much evidence that collusion with the President of the United States actually occurred. So I believe in the rule of law in America that you should be innocent until proven guilty. Our president, I truly believe him when he says that he didn't collude with them. I do. Now, as to your question, is our president doing enough? I think just recently, in the last couple of days, he came out pretty strong and letting the Russian leadership know that this shall not stand. And I think he is doing a good job in making sure that Russia understands that this is America and we have a process that must be respected. So I personally think our president is doing a great job as it pertains to the big issues in America defending us against ISIS. Clearly, we can all say that that has definitely improved. That evidence shows that. And as to Russia, he's put them on notice. I mean, clearly, by changing the Secretary of State with the current CIA, sends a message to North Korea and Russia probably that, you know, there's a new way of looking at things.
Wait, didn't Tillerson get fired because he said that Russia was involved in, like, drugging a British agent, and Russia was mad about that? How would that showcase that he's tough on Russia?
Drugging the Russian agent who was expatriate in London.
Yeah.
And like, his wife, yes.
Okay, how would that show that he's tough with Russia?
I think the fact that he's put it in the form of the CIA director now to be the Secretary of State clearly shows that he's looking at a new direction of foreign policy. And I commend the president mm-hmm. for making these wise choices, because the president likely knows what many of us know mm-hmm. of what the real threats to our nation are. And what we need to do as U.S. senators to ensure that the president continues to, and our people, most importantly, it's the American people, can feel that they can be safe and secure to know that there are people that know what they're doing to defend our nation. And I, for one, think that our president is overall doing a great job as to the economy and the safety and security, defending our borders. I'm all in favor of a lot of what he's doing with immigration. Remember, my mother and father were legal Italian immigrants. They spent 7 years or so. They told me the whole process. It wasn't easy. They didn't sneak in here and just do whatever they wanted. I love the fact that our president's saying enough of this madness, because we're dreamers too, 300 million of us that have to pay taxes and pay for the education and all the other things for these illegals that are coming in here. So I commend our president for having the integrity, and that's why he won, I think. I think most people are saying enough of this craziness. We have a president saying secure our borders, make our military strong again, get less tax, less government, drain the swamp. Wow. Let's make America great again. I'll be honest with you, I think America's always been great, okay? I like the fact, let's make America even greater. But I like the fact that our president is doing a good job overall.
Now, one of the big issues that Congress has had to deal with, or not, depending on which side you're on, is health care. And in fact, in the recent special election in Pennsylvania for a new member of Congress, the reason I bring this up is that the exit polls show that 52% of the people who voted, health care was their top issue. So I think that's why that's been already emphasized by Claire McCaskill a lot.
Yes.
Whether one agrees or disagrees, she's hammering on health care. Hawley has been doing that, but to a lesser extent. So my question is, how would you deal with this? I mean, there's a battle over whether or not to keep the Affordable Care Act, but regardless, you still have tens of millions of people who either who have to get health care on their own. Their companies don't provide it. Increasingly, companies aren't because it's too expensive. You've got the issue of tens of millions who get health care through Medicaid, which is for low income. And all this is something that's on congressional desks and big in the Senate. How would you deal with that?
All right, excellent. I'm so glad you asked me, and you're right, because I've been doing this for a year. I go out to talk to the people. The main thing I hear all the time is health care. So here's what I would do. First of all, as a businessman and as someone that started a Big Brothers and Sisters, how did I do that? I bring people together. I look at the facts. Have y'all ever heard of Lean Six Sigma? It's a way of process improvement where you look at the facts and the data, and it's all about process, and then you continuously improve that, okay? You standardize, you stabilize, and continuously improve. So now I would say, let's look at it from targeting the chaos. There's chaos right now in this country as it pertains to our health care. It was supposed to be Affordable Care Act. It was anything but affordable. It was less care, and it cost us more. We all know that. Pelosi saying you don't have to pass it until you read it. That's ridiculous. You have 7 years of Republicans saying we're going to repeal and replace. They're finally in power. They don't do that. Blah, blah, blah. We're done. Here's what I would do. Ready? Number one, let's bring people together, Republicans, Democrats, and Independents. In these two, maybe three areas, I assure you we can get common sense agreement on. Tort reform. When I speak with doctors and nurses and people, they say, the number one thing I tell my kids, don't even think about being a doctor, because you get sued all the time. He goes, so why don't we look at tort reform, and let's find common sense solutions to give people the right care that they should be getting. But a lot of these doctors, they have chest pain. Instead of giving you two aspirin, call me in the morning, they start all of a sudden giving you all these tests that you really don't need. So tort reform. Number two, prescription drug prices. Everyone listening right now probably saying, it's ridiculous that I can't go to Mexico or Canada and buy my drugs for 10 cents on the dollar because some pharmaceutical companies or lobbyist groups are pulling the strings on a lot of these congressmen and senators. I assure you there. And three, health savings accounts. Why don't we give young people health savings accounts and then give them an opportunity to save on this? And then let's look at how we can improve the system as far as interstate insurance. And why are we not focusing on those three areas? I assure you, if we did that, then we can look at the other issues as to tackling this challenge that we have as a nation.
Aren't health savings accounts available already for people?
Yes, they are.
How many
people listening to this radio show, call in later on.
Sure.
Tell them if you have a health savings account. Do me a favor. I had
a health savings account for one job, and it was fine, but I think I would have preferred a traditional insurance plan. But I understand why they're around to be more affordable for businesses and
well, for some medical expenses. But let's say you're in a car accident, your health savings account isn't going to, or let's say you get diagnosed with cancer or something, your health savings account isn't going to come up with nearly enough money to help cover those huge bills you would face. For decades, many Americans got insurance through their jobs, and it was cheaper. It's not now. I mean, regardless.
Agreed.
And you're a businessman, so
sure.
You're very aware of how much it can cost if a business tries to offer it. So, and the whole issue of pre-existing conditions, where, I mean, one of the reasons the Affordable Care Act passed, and I'm not endorsing it, I'm just saying one of the reasons that it was passed was because so many people could not get insurance if they weren't in a group health plan. They couldn't get it. I mean, because there would be some sort of pre-existing condition, they would say you're not qualified. And so many people are concerned that they could be returning back to that. So how would you deal with that? Because I think that's all these issues that end up being bombarded, and they end up on the desk of U.S. senators.
I agree. And here's what I'm saying to the American people right now. I don't want the federal government doing it. That's what I'm saying. I want it to be at the states. let the states and local governments decide. And if you agree with that, you stay in that state and you work with the state government. But I don't want more federal government in our lives. I have found, as a person that's been around for about almost 54 years, that whenever the federal government thinks it's a good idea and they get involved in our lives, they just mess things up. Do you know, I was reading today that President Lincoln started the agricultural department. There was one farmer for every one farmer, there was like, no, for every one guy in the ag department, there was 227,000 farmers. Now it's one for every 16. How are my farmers that live in the state going to make it when you have so much fourth government bureaucracy? I've lived in countries where there's social medicine. I've had a problem and woke up in the hospital with six other people, and a guy next to me died. And I'm thinking, do we really want socialized medicine? Is this where we're going as a nation? No. We have the greatest health care in the world. We don't have a health care crisis. We have an insurance crisis. Let's deal with that reality. Don't get federal government in our lives when it comes to this. Go to the state. Let's focus on tort reform. Let's do prescription drugs. Let's look at innovative solutions for the states, but don't get the government involved.
Now, you mentioned that America has always been great, and I would generally agree with that. But frankly, there are people of color in this country who don't agree with that. Maybe our African-American neighbors, their ancestors were brought here because of slavery, and then in subsequent generations, they were systematically discriminated against by the federal and state governments. You know, we live in a state that we're only 4 years removed from Ferguson, which was a national situation that I think started a movement in this country to bring accountability to law enforcement. I think that a lot of those policies have to be drafted on a local and state level, but federal sometimes plays a role, especially when it deals with the Department of Justice. I asked a similar question like this to Austin Peterson. I want to know how you're going to make lives better for some of the people that haven't been treated well by America or its government, and that's minorities.
You know, I love that question, too. I'm really enjoying this, and here's why. You know, back in, I think it was early 90s, my wife and I decided to become a big brother and sister mm-hmm. to someone, and we did, to an African-American young man. I don't want to get into his name and all that. But
that's fine.
Yeah, but I can just tell you that changed my life. I learned so much about that because he was growing up with not knowing who his father was. Mother was in jail for drugs, living with five brothers and sisters in a small house with grandma. And I tried so hard to understand, you know, how I could best help, you know, him. And it was, you know, how you always hear in life that when you do something for someone else, they're, you know, what they did for you is better for what you did for them. That's where I was at. Afterwards, when I got to the University of Central Missouri, I started what's called the Red Tail Initiative. Maybe y'all don't know this, but I sat in front of everybody and I said, someday, Choose Red will take on new meaning at UCM, University of Central Missouri, because that's our logo, Choose Red. And I said, all of our tails will be painted red to honor the Tuskegee Airmen, who are my heroes. And I said, and what I want to do is bring us together as a nation and see what we could do to learn from the examples of what happened in our history. We should embrace our history and look at our Tuskegee Airmen, that because of their color of their skin, they were not allowed to fly. They had to fight for the right to fight for us. Is that crazy? They are my heroes. And I love encouraging students and families to learn. So when it came to Ferguson, it broke my heart, because in the military, we're brothers and sisters. We're not black, white, yellow, green. We're Americans. We should look to our heroes. Instead of looking at Hollywood and putting capes on people, let's look at the red tail. So what am I going to do as your next U.S. senator? I'm going to go to Ferguson. I'm already doing it. I want to be a senator before I'm a senator. And I meet with people, and I listen to them, and they tell me the same thing, that there's a lack of hope, and there's no jobs. And that they don't have families, a lot of the inner city. They tell me this. At least this is what they're telling me. And it's so important to rebuild our communities, not with the federal government, but with mothers and fathers and community leaders and religious organizations. That's where the solution lies, not the federal government.
Okay, well, no, thanks for being on the show. I mean, this has been really terrific. Our whole aim has been trying to get people to lay out the issues, what they stand for, so our listeners have a sense of who the people are. And is there any parting words that you want to have for our listeners?
Yeah, the main parting words is that a lot of people say I can't do it because I don't have the money. And that's where I'm hoping that there's listeners that are going to go to MannettiForSenate.com. They're going to not only just go look at my website and learn about me, but I'm asking, can you help a veteran? Can you find 10 people to give $10? I mean, that's how we're going to win this. I don't want $50,000 chicken dinners, but I got to be honest with you, I need your help. If we want to change the culture, you're going to have to give a guy like me an opportunity to serve again. I'm Lieutenant Colonel Tony Monetti, retired B-2 stealth bomber pilot, restaurant owner, community leader, but most importantly, I love my country and I'm ready to serve again. The question is, are you ready for Monetti?
And how would people follow you on Twitter?
Yes, if you go to Monetti for Senate, the number four.
Number four.
Yes, sir. That's
not,
right.
Not the word four.
Yes.
The number four.
Yes, sir.
And how could people follow you on Twitter, Joe?
It's J Mannies. It's J-M-A-N-N-I-E-S.
And, you know, listeners across the state, you can follow me on Twitter at J Rosenbaum. And for all of our stories, go to STL Public Radio. I'm Jason Rosenbaum, and I'm letting you know throughout this state and country that you will succeed. Have a great week, folks.
If you have a smart speaker, you have access to the entire world of NPR and St. Louis Public Radio. All the latest news and all the captivating stories. Activate our voices with yours by telling your smart speaker to play St. Louis Public Radio.